PA instead of some digital cable. So I want to talk today about a problem that, since this conference is about interfaces and about two dimensions, I mean, two dimensions appears quite a bit, I want to talk about this problem of what happens near the so-called superconductor insulator transition in two dimensions. This work started many years ago at Stanford with my first student in this subject, Elias Dani, and continued all the way to Nick Bresnay. Much of the new stuff I'm going to talk about came from his work. So the standard paradigm assumes that in the presence of disorder, as the temperature goes to zero, the only stable phases in two-dimensional electron gas are either an insulating phase, so the conductivity tensor will go to zero, the resistivity tensor will diverge as you go to T equals zero. A superconducting phase, so below a certain transition temperature, TC, the conductivity will diverge, the longitudinal resistivity will go to zero, but because of electron hole symmetry, the hole conductivity will also vanish. And there are various, in strong magnetic field, various quantum Hall fluids in which the longitudinal resistivity goes to zero, but the transverse resistivity is quantized. Now, in particular, there can be no metallic phases in two dimensions, according to this standard paradigm. So the outline of this talk is actually going to be about studying thin superconducting films, and oxide interfaces do provide you with such an environment, show phenomena that challenge this standard paradigm. So I'm going to talk about disordered two-dimensional superconductors. So just a reminder, in a superconductor below a certain temperature, call it TC0, you lower the temperature, you measure the resistance of a sample, and the resistance vanishes below a certain temperature. You apply a magnetic field. This is a thin superconductor. This will always be what are called type 2 superconductors. At low fields, the magnetic field will be expelled, but for a thin superconductor, usually this phase is suppressed, and what you get is vortices going into the superconductor and arrange themselves in an Abrikosov lattice. Above a certain field, the Abrikosov lattice will melt, and at the same time, superconductivity will disappear, as Cooper pairs will disappear as well. That's in general for three-dimensional superconductors. In two dimensions, the situation is different. For example, you cannot have a true superconducting transition at that TC0. Instead, at temperature lower than that, called the Costa-Lestaulis transition temperature, there is another phenomena of binding of vortex-anti-vortex pairs. Below that, you have a finite superfluid density and then a true superconducting phase. Now, this is very important because, in principle, there is only one superconducting transition temperature, okay? Now, as we know from Abrikosov, to define vortices, you need a finite superfluid density. Nevertheless, we are talking about proliferation of vortices just above this Costa-Lestaulis transition, despite the fact that there is no superfluid density. So the idea is that close enough to this TKT, the Costa-Lestaulis transition, then the pair amplitude fluctuates very slowly, and over finite length scales, you can still define vortices, and then these vortices will bind at the Costa-Lestaulis transition. This is very important because this is going to come back when we are talking about the zero temperature superconductor to insulator transition. Now, all this consideration was at finite disorder, but strictly zero magnetic field. If you apply a magnetic field with no disorder, you'll get again, and of course there is no Meissner state, you'll get again an Abrikosov state that is going to melt now via dislocation pairs unbinding transition, similar to vortex anti-vortex unbinding transition. Then at zero temperature, you may get quantum melting of this superconducting of this vortex lattice. Now, in the presence of disorder in this 2D, you nucleate dislocations already at any finite temperature. And what was shown in a series of papers over the years is basically you cannot get any temperature, any finite superconductivity at any finite temperature in the presence of magnetic field, namely in the presence of vortices and therefore dislocations, in the presence of disorder. So this leads us to this phase diagram for two-dimensional superconductors in which, and you see this is an open circle, which means that as you go, of course, in the thermodynamic limit from a strictly zero magnetic field to a finite magnetic field, then you get at zero disorder to a recursive lattice. But once disorder is present, then the only possible transition is at zero temperature. People coined this vortex glass because of this disordered array of vortices, but the nature of this phase, as well as the phases above it, are still under discussion. So in the presence of disorder, as we are talking now only about infinite magnetic field, you will get quantum critical behavior as a function of magnetic field, or as you increase disorder at strictly zero magnetic field, you will get a situation similar here as a function of temperature. Again, zero field, there is going to be a disorder-tuned superconductor to insulator transition, with the idea that above, as you lose superconductivity, the standard paradigm says, you will get an insulating phase. Indeed, early measurements of the group of Alan Goldman at Minnesota show that if you take a superconducting film, you make it disordered. In that case, they simply thinned it down, or in fact, they built up the thickness and measured the resistance as a function of temperature. They saw that above a certain, they start from thin films, the behavior was insulating. Below, above a certain thickness, then there is a superconducting transition below some temperature. And then there is a separatrix here that separates a superconducting behavior from an insulating behavior. On the other hand, making different films with different disorder by making different thicknesses, you may think that it's really not the same material. The magnetic field-tuned superconductor to insulator transition is a little bit more simpler to understand, because you take one film that you make in the lab, it's one realization of the disorder, and now you tune another parameter, for example, the magnetic field, and you can go through this quantum critical point of the superconductor to presumably insulating transition. This is data from the first paper in the subject, the Hebbard and Palanen paper. I'll come back to this paper later. So what about probing quantum critical points? We are talking now about quantum critical phenomena of this superconductor to insulator transition. So for a normal critical point, for example, the superconducting transition, this is a governed by thermal fluctuations, you scale various thermodynamic quantities with these diverging lengths that will diverge as you get close to the transition temperature. Okay? But as you change some parameter, for example, this x, the transition temperature may go down and down and down until you get to zero temperature. And at zero temperature, I think everybody can hear me, isn't it?
It's for the video.
The superconducting transition any transition that is tuned by this parameter is now at zero temperature, and we have now a zero temperature quantum phase transition in which tuning that parameter through a critical value will go from some value to say some behavior to long range order. Now, how do we probe that? Obviously, we probe a quantum critical point from finite temperature. I mean, any attempt to probe it at zero temperature failed so far. The way we do it is, in fact, looking at this quantum critical point, and remembering that since it is a quantum phase transition, it's governed not only by a diverging correlation length with respect to this quantity, say x in this case, but also we need to supplement it with the dynamics, and the dynamics is given by some vanishing frequency, omega, that will vanish with some power of the diverging lengths, and we call this z the dynamical exponent. Now, obviously, as we said, we are measuring the system at a finite temperature, which means that this vanishing frequency is going to be cut off by K Boltzmann T, and as it is cut off by K Boltzmann T, it defines a new length, this LT, and this LT now defines a quantum critical regime as long as you are within this quantum critical funnel, you do feel this quantum critical point, okay? So our approach is going to be stay within this quantum critical regime, this funnel, and you will be able to probe this quantum critical point. I want to emphasize that for this quantum critical point, which is at zero temperature, if the temperature at which you measure is 1 millikelvin or 100 Kelvin may not matter from the point of view of zero temperature as long as there is nothing else happening and you already established the phase that you are going to talk about. So there is a problem, and the problem is, despite all what I said, is that there are other phenomena that may mask this quantum critical point. For example, there is another thing that happens as you get lower in temperature. For example, we all know in high temperature superconductors, you try to get down to some quantum critical point that many groups are trying to study, but superconductivity, in fact, comes along and masks the quantum critical point. Other problems is you go to low temperatures, we rely on the fact that the sample is in thermal equilibrium, but as you go to low temperatures, electron-phonon interaction, for example, can get weaker and weaker, and non-equilibrium effects may become important. So again, it's a problem as you get to low temperatures. Another possibility is that as you try to get close to the quantum critical point, you get to lower temperatures, and then something else happens, and you flow away from this quantum critical point. For example, there is another parameter that becomes relevant and important, and you no longer feel this quantum critical point. All these need to be taken into considerations when you look at a quantum critical point. I will want, in this talk, to concentrate on the magnetic field-tuned superconductor-to-insulator transition. Remember that. One realization gives me this quantum critical point, and I will want to study that. So first, general considerations. We said that we expect the superconducting phase to go into an insulating phase, but the question is, what kind of insulating phase? Now, if at that transition we lose completely Cooper pairs, like it happens in a mean field fashion, then we are going back to a Fermi system, and we expect normal behavior, normal insulating behavior. If it's a weak superconductor, then it's going to be weak localization. Strong disorder may give me strong localization, all the things that we know about within the so-called standard paradigm. On the other hand, remember this discussion that we had here near the Koster-Listowless transition. Suppose that we are still at this superconductor to something transition, and Cooper pairs can still be considered as staying intact because, for example, the amplitude fluctuates very, very slowly. If that's the case, I can still define here Cooper pairs and associated vortices at some finite length scale, and therefore I can consider a superconductor to a Bose insulator because now I'm dominated by the bosons, the Cooper pairs, rather than this normal superconductor to a Fermi insulator transition. Which one? This we will call phase-dominated scenario, where this is the amplitude-dominated scenario. Now, which one will be more important? It's easy to see that I can, if I calculate the scale for phase fluctuations, which will give me that the Bose insulator is the dominated one, it's simply integrating the kinetic energy of the electrons, I will get a scale that is very similar to the Costa-Listowel scale, which means that as I get thinner and thinner, not me, the superconducting films, then that scale, temperature scale, becomes smaller and smaller and become the relevant one. The smallest one is the relevant one. And if this is the relevant one, then the SIT should be dominated by phase fluctuations, and therefore we can talk about a superconductor to a Bose insulator transition rather than superconductor to a Fermi insulator like we used to when we talked about normal BCS transition. Okay, this means that the cast of characters, if you want, of this transition are the superconducting Cooper pairs, these are the bosons, and the associated vortices, and there is duality relations between them, and I will come back to the duality relation later in the talk. So if I'm going from a superconducting transition at which the resistance is zero to an insulating behavior where the resistance diverges now because of Bose localization, then at the boundary I expect the resistance to stay finite as you go to zero temperature, and we will call that Bose metal. Okay? Now, it's not difficult to construct a scaling analysis for this transition. We have a diverging length, that length that diverges as we get close to this magnetic field tune transition. We also have this vanishing frequency that is going to be cut off by K Boltzmann T, therefore defining these thermal lengths. Then these two lengths will give me a scaling for the resistivity that goes like the ratio of these two lengths. Obviously, there is nothing else up front because in two dimensions, the resistivity is dimensionless. So it's just a number. We will call it rho C. It turned that the same as the KT can limit the vanishing frequency. Also, an electric field can do that as long as you make sure that you are at temperatures high compared to the electron-phonon temperature. So that works as well, which gives you another scaling function now for the ratio of the diverging lengths over the electric field energy or length scale that you get in the same fashion as we got LT. So now we have two scaling functions, and we can try and scale our data as we obtain it towards the superconductor to insulator transition. And if we do get these two scaling functions, then you see that scaling it with the electric field, here is the voltage, or the temperature, solving the two equations can give me Z and nu independently. Okay? Now, the first measurements of this magnetic field tune transition was done by Hebbard and Palanen, and they did the following thing. Here is our quantum critical point. The transition occurs at HC, the quantum, the critical field. And then what they measured is the resistance as a function of temperature, and they decided to plot the temperature on a log scale, so it kind of looks weird. But what you see is that as you go to low temperatures, showing here as flowing towards the critical point, obviously, as you are within the quantum critical regime, you start to feel, of course, you have to be much below this TC naught, which is the pairing amplitude for this system, and they will. And then as you start to flow, you cross the funnel, you then feel either a superconducting behavior here, or if you cross the funnel at this magnetic field, you become an insulator. But if you stay within the funnel, you see that the resistances seem to stay constant, which means that you feel this quantum critical point. Then, according to this scaling behavior, you note that since the pre-factor is a constant, then if you are at HC, at the critical field, then the argument here is zero, and therefore your longitudinal resistivity is a constant. So from the point of view of measuring magnetoresistance or isotherms of resistance versus magnetic field, you should get a crossing point. Well, this was not a very good crossing point at the time when Hebbard and Palanen did that in 1990. Nevertheless, they did use some average point here and were able to do this crossing, which they did, and found that there are two branches, either below the critical field or above the critical field, and then there is a parameter Z nu, which is the scaling parameter in the scaling function. As you can see here, they only did temperature scaling and found that this is of about 1.3. Now, I flashed it, but in principle, it is expected that this amplitude will be of order of the quantum of resistance for Cooper pairs, which is H over the charge square. The charge is 2E, so H over 4E square, which is about 6.5 kilo-ohms. They found numbers of order of a few kilo-ohms, but never really these 6.5. Okay, now the phase diagram, as we showed it, for example here, talks about the axis of disorder. So there is weak disorder and there is strong disorder. So I want to talk about weak versus strong disorder. So here it is. If I'm making a film with realization of disorder, which is close here, that's a weak disorder regime, in principle, may expect to get different behavior than when I make a film that is going across here at the strong disorder regime. Okay? So if I increase the magnetic field, I go through the superconductor to whatever insulator transition, but may then still tune the disorder. Now, in weak disorder, and this is now quite universal for many, many groups who since have been measuring in that regime, is that yes, there is this crossing point that we talked about. However, the resistance at this crossing point seems to be of order of the normal state resistance, not much different, definitely not close to 6.5 kilo-ohm. And the magnetoresistance, which you expect to be more and more insulating, is very, very weak. Okay? So weak disorder signature the appearance of some weird phase, which is a metallic phase. Remember, the standard paradigm says that there is no metallic phase in two dimensions. These are all measurements from Yazdani et al. On molybdenum germanium. Resistance goes from a superconducting to insulating. This particular one has a weak disorder, so it goes into weak localization type of behavior. Nevertheless, there is a crossing point, and there is pretty good scaling, both for the temperature and the electric field. And the problem is that scaling is disrupted as you go to low temperatures. And scaling is disrupted because there is an appearance of this kind of metallic phase. Here it is shown as the resistance of the sample as a function of inverse temperature. So going there, going to the right means going to zero temperature. And you see that the resistance levels to a finite value, which is several orders of magnitude lower than the normal state resistance. We claimed at the time that this is a new phase. I think that by now it's been measured in other samples. And in other systems. Nevertheless, if you do go to much lower magnetic fields, then there is a true superconducting transition. Here you can see it here. So if the crossing point here was at around 4 kilo-gauss, then it is at 200 gauss, it goes into a true superconducting phase. And in between, you have this saturation of the resistance that is this metallic phase. By now, this metallic phase has been observed in other systems, arrays of dots of superconductor on a metal in the group of Nadia Mason, arrays of dots on graphene by the group of Vincent Bouchier. Peter Armitage was measuring metallic behavior in amorphous indium oxide films. Niobium silicon films were measured in OSE, also with the metallic behavior. You can see the resistance seems to saturate. Some new results that we obtained that are not published yet, which tells you something about the character of this metallic phase, is in this tantalum nitride film that you see here. Again, the resistance is a function of 1 over temperature. There is saturation of the resistance at low magnetic fields. If you measure, this is the crossing point, again, very weak magnetoresistance. But if you measure the Hall effect, you see that as you go to low temperatures, and this supposedly green curve is now measurement of the Hall effect down to 100 millikelvin, that's the Rxy as a function of magnetic field, you see that the Hall effect remains zero, as much as we can tell, up to a very, very high fields. Fields much higher than where we see the occurrence of this metallic phase. This means that this anomalous metallic phase shows zero Hall effect, namely it shows a character of electron hole symmetry, just like a superconducting phase. So it gives you some idea about that. Now I want to move to strong disorder, which is going to be the main subject of this talk. And in strong disorder, then on a scale of now going down to, in this case, to 200 millikelvin, by that time, the normal state resistance that started at a couple of kilo ohms now gets to mega ohms. You cannot even see the crossing point, but if you did, you would see that it crosses with a critical resistance of order of 6.5 kilo ohms, namely H over 4 E squared. And as you go to lower temperatures, this magnetoresistance becomes stronger and stronger. We call this the strong disorder regime. It is characterized by this very strong magnetoresistance. As you can see, unlike the weak disorder, in which the magnetoresistance was very weak and never really even approached the quantum of resistance for fermions of H over E squared, this one goes way, way above that number and therefore cannot really be any true Fermi insulating behavior. Especially as you go to higher fields, we can show that this Fermi insulating behavior is recovered. If you do scaling now at this critical point, here is for this example, what you get is that this combination of Z nu, and if you separate them, Z seems to be 1 and nu of order of these 2.5, is a number that I'll come back to it, start to resemble very much numbers that have been observed in quantum Hall liquid to insulator transition and in quantum percolation simulations. In this case, this is the critical resistance, about 6.5. However, in fields that we measured, we see this to be anywhere between 6 and 6.5, and we attribute this simply to our lack of being able to accurately measure the R per square. Indeed, in two dimensions, the resistivity is dimensionless, but still you need to measure where the current flow as you, and where you measure the voltage to determine the resistance in order to determine the so-called number of squares in your samples, and an error of 10% is quite reasonable. So this kind of strong disorder was observed in other groups. That's the group of Dani Shahar at Weizmann, the group of Tatiana Baturina. They all observed this kind of behavior in the strong disorder regime, in which the magnetoresistance seems to go to extremely large value. OK. Again, as we, I started to show you some unpublished results getting some new insight from Hall effect. I want to talk about new insight from Hall effect now in the strong disorder regime. And I want to talk about Hall effect and the so-called Hall insulator phase. So Hebbard and Palanen measured, a couple of years after they published their first paper, they measured the Hall effect. And what they observed is that, this is from their paper from 92, they observed that yes, there is a superconductor to insulator transition, where I point here. The Hall effect is zero up to this transition as you increase the magnetic field. This is resistance, longitudinal resistance, and this is the magnetic field. It is zero. Well, it's expected to be zero in a superconducting phase, of course. But then the Hall effect starts to increase, but it's kind of tight, as you can see. And then above a certain point, it seems to splay out. For some samples, as they zoomed in, they saw that maybe there is also a crossing point for the Hall resistance as a function of magnetic field. Okay. Now, this was not repeated since 92, and we thought that maybe it's time to go back and examine more the behavior of the Hall effect. Now, experimentally, measuring the Hall effect is not easy for samples in which the resistance diverges. Because the way we measure the Hall effect is we put longitudinal current and we measure transverse voltage. And of course, we always have misalignment, or if you have either inhomogeneities or inherent or appearing in the sample, current flow is not straight. And you get contribution from the longitudinal component. If the longitudinal component is very large, then even though you can subtract upfield and downfield and divide by two to get the Hall coefficient, you know very well that to measure the weight of a captain of a ship, you don't measure the ship with the captain and the ship without the captain and subtract the two. So when you get to very high longitudinal resistances, you cannot really take field up and field down and subtract. It simply is too difficult. There are other schemes that we tried to use, and we used, in fact, in the data I'm going to show, this is what we used. But the bottom line is you cannot go to too low temperatures if you want to measure the Hall effect, because the resistance diverges, the longitudinal resistance diverges, which influences the resistance diverges. The longitudinal resistance diverges. Yeah, in the insulator. No, I'm talking about measuring in the insulating side. The longitudinal resistance diverges, and you cannot subtract the two in order to get in a true superconductor, the hole is zero. Okay, but we already discussed the approach to a quantum critical point. What's the question? We already discussed the fact that we are approaching a quantum critical point, and we can still say something about this quantum critical point as long as we are within the quantum critical funnel. If we already established the character of this superconducting state. So if we are here at higher temperatures, okay, you see here, that's when the resistance gets very large. I mean, in this case, it gets to mega ohms, and it becomes difficult, and we try to subtract field up, field down. So this gives you this line if you try to be within the funnel. But as long as you are within the funnel, you don't really need to go in this case, I think, 100 or 200 millik. You can stay at 100. You can stay at 200 millik, which is here. And the resistance is lower, and you can, in this case, it's 200 kilo ohm, and you subtract, and you can still get the Hall effect. And as long as you are within the quantum critical funnel, you can say something about the quantum critical point. Similarly, if you do have non-equilibrium effects that set in below a certain temperature, just make sure that you are at high enough temperatures but you are within this quantum critical fund. And that this was the approach that we took. Here is one sample. This is the longitudinal resistance. Here is the crossing point. Here it is zooming on the crossing point. And this is the Hall effect. Here is the crossing point. Here is zooming on the crossing point. It looks very similar to the Hebbard and Palanen. Here is another sample. This time we took it to the magnet lab. The idea was we can there go to very high fields and completely kill any vestiges of superconductivity and therefore obtain what's the actual slope and therefore the actual carrier density, for example, from the normal, usual H over NEC relation. So this is indium oxide. I'm sorry. All this strong insulating behavior is indium oxide. Yes. Sorry?
The same as Gabriel.
Yes. Well, it was made in a different way. I think that there are many ways in the and but in principle it is indium and oxygen. Again, you see that there is a weak crossing here at the hole for the hole coefficient, as there is for the longitudinal resistance. And what we did now is we said, okay, we cannot go to low temperatures, but let's try and extrapolate the resistance and the Hall resistance in the limit of T goes to zero from these higher temperature regimes. Before that, I just want to show that if you do scaling for the longitudinal conductivity, either as a function of temperature that's here or electric field, you get that Z nu again is this number which is around 2.3, 2.4, 2.5, and the 1 plus Z is here 4.4. If you solve these two, you get very good agreement with the Z equal to 1, and nu is about 2.3. So I told you that we take now the limit of T goes to 0, and this is it. This is the limit of T goes to 0 of rho xy, okay, that we measure. As I said, we cannot measure rho xy at very low temperatures, so we took that limit. And this is what, and the other benefit of measuring rho xy and rho xx is the fact that you can invert the matrix. So I can also have sigma xy and sigma xx. But in this case, I'm interested in rho xy and rho xx, and I'm plotting now rho xy scaled by h over 4e squared, which is the scale of the Hall resistance, and sigma xy by 4e squared over h. If I do that, then this is now absolute scale for these two, and what you see is that at the superconductor to insulator transition, rho xy is zero, that's the blue dots, and then it starts to pick up. Sigma xy is zero above, and then start to go down. There is the inverse relation because when you invert sigma is minus rho xy over rho xx squared plus rho xy squared. And I'm going to concentrate on the vicinity of the superconductor to insulator transition. So this is a magnification of that. And what you see is, again, rho xy is zero and picks up above. Sigma xy is finite and zero above. Okay? And since it's an absolute scale, then, as I drew here, it's very tempting to have to see whether there is a straight line going through the two, which there is, and this is a signature of self-duality. So self-duality emerged in this kind of a system, which is a real surprise. Okay? So let me talk a little bit about self-duality. If you talk about the motion of vortices in a superconductor, you can show that there is a Magnus force operating on the vortex from which you can get a vortex electric field, from which you can write the current for both the Cooper pairs and for the vortices, from which you can show that there is a relation between the conductivity of the actual conductivity that you measure, this is the Levi-Civita tensor, and the vortex resistivity, and what connects them, in this case is this, I'm multiplying by four, I mean, everything here is in this dimensionless units of dividing conductivity by 4e squared over h, resistivity by h over 4e squared. So if I invert now the resistivity tensor for the vortex, I get a relation for the duality between the measured conductivity and the vortex conductivity, which is given in this way. Okay? But we are talking about self-duality. And self-duality happens when the current density of Cooper pairs is the same as the current density for vortices. So that's the surprise, because the number of vortices is much, much lower than the number of Cooper pairs. Nevertheless, we see emergence of self-duality. Okay? By the way, if you impose this condition for self-duality, you immediately get these two equations. One is that sigma xx squared for vortices plus sigma xy squared is this universal number 4e squared over h, and that the transpose of the measured conductivity is the vortex conductivity. Okay? Yes, yes. But, in fact, I can have other, I can show you other situations in which, despite the fact that these two current densities are the same, the requirement can be achieved of these two current densities, despite the fact that the number of Cooper pairs is much larger than the number of vortices. Take a single Josephson junction, okay? I have two puddles of superconductor. The number of Josephson junctions here is very large. Nevertheless, the only thing that matters here is if for a single Cooper pair that crosses the junction, there is one vortex that traverses the junction and creates the voltage across the junction, then I can calculate the voltage drop according to the Josephson relation, and then from theta, if I divide by 2 pi, I get the number, I get the phase and therefore the number of vortices that traverse the junction, and here the current is the number of Cooper pairs that go through the junction. The resistance of this Josephson junction is given by h over 4e squared times the ratio of these rates. And if this ratio of these rates is the same, which I can achieve despite the fact that I have more Cooper pairs, but all I need is one tunneling of one Cooper pair, then the critical resistance is this h over 4e squared. So if I have an inhomogeneous system with a lot of Josephson junctions there, then this could be a solution for this emergence of self-duality. Okay, let me go back now to this new phase near the SIT. So let's take now above the SIT, I'm in the insulating phase, let's take, I don't know, 6 Tesla and look at the longitudinal and transverse resistances. The longitudinal resistance, as you can see here, diverges. The transverse one is finite and below H over NEC. Okay? Now, what does it mean? When the longitudinal resistance diverges and the transverse, the Hall resistance is finite, this is what is called Hall insulator. This is a phase that was predicted long time ago by Kivelson, Lee, and Zhang for the quantum Hall system, was observed, as I'll show in a minute, in the quantum Hall system, but was never observed in this two-dimensional superconductor to insulator. Well, it seems that we see this phase, by the way, at the crossing of the Hall effect, we get exactly to this H over NEC, which is the canonical value for a Hall insulator, as predicted by Kivelson, Li, and Zhang. But there is an additional ingredient here, which we found here, which is of self-duality. Now, I don't have much time, so I'm going to skip this. There is a global consistency check in which if you look on the insulating side and you have a scale for the diverging resistance, then it's the same scale that should be for the diverging conductance on the superconducting side. You can invent a scaling function that I'm showing you how we test it here. I'll be happy to show the scaling later. I think it's more important to see how it works. So this is the longitudinal resistance as a function of temperature, and these are the fits. And these fits yield this T naught, this scale. And as you can see, plotting this scale now as a function of magnetic field give me again this Z nu exponent that I showed you before. And you see that over almost five orders of magnitude, I have this scaling with this exponent of 2.3. So previously predicted and observed Hall insulator phase, I said it was predicted by Kivelson, Li, and Zhang for the quantum Hall liquid to insulator transition, was observed by the group of Odweng Jiang and group of Dan Tsui with Dan Shachar. Now we claim that it also appears here in the quantum holic, in the superconductor to insulator transition, which now through this same exponent, through this same behavior, we actually believe that they are in the same universality class. Indeed, in these measurements of Wong, they found this Hall insulator, namely divergence of the longitudinal resistance and finite Hall insulator. That's their scaling. By the way, their scaling gives you again this H, now H over E squared, because the E squared, E is the charge, and their Z nu is again this 2.3, again showing same universality class. And then the duality, well, the duality was observed again in these systems of quantum Hall liquid to insulator transition. Here, results of Dan Shachar at the time. They observed the duality through the IV measurements, showing that I goes to V, V goes to I, as you are below and above that transition. As they noted in the abstract, that this result can be interpreted as evidence for the existence of charge flux duality symmetry in that system. That's the quantum Hall liquid to insulator. Now we are saying that it's the same thing in the superconductor to insulator. So, as I said, there can be arguments against duality. For example, the interaction of the Cooper pairs is still long range, I mean, Coulomb interaction, despite that these are films. It goes in all directions, and that the density of Cooper pairs is much, much smaller than the density of vortices, but as we argue, these two issues will not matter if the system is inherently inhomogeneous. And I think that there are many, many evidences that this system near the superconductor to insulator transition is indeed inhomogeneous. And what we are talking about is really percolation of puddles, this transition. So basically, if we are here above the transition, above the critical field or in the insulating phase, then there is going to be quantum tunneling plus interference plus whatever there is, such that below this critical field, we will have a quantum percolation type of description, very similar to the one shown for the quantum Hall transition by Chokeren and Coddington in 88. This kind of puddle type behavior was discussed by many. Spivak, I think, was the first, and then there were others talking about disorder that induced local gap inhomogeneities in Landini-Trivetti's group, in Egan Meyer's group. Others discussed what happens when you simply have a situation of breakdown into puddles because, say, proximity to first order transition, etc. But the inherent inhomogeneities is something that I think is now well established also in this superconductor to insulator transition. And therefore, the idea that what we have is something that is governed by the inhomogeneities and something similar to what happens with Josephson junctions is not unusual. So this brings me to the basically phase diagram. It's not exactly a phase diagram because what I plot here is temperature, magnetic field, and this axis is the resistivity that I'm two-dimensional resistivity, either longitudinal or whole. For the longitudinal, that's the blue, I expect that up to the superconductor to insulator transition, I have zero resistance, and then it diverges. That's the Bose insulating phase. This is the quantum critical point of that Bose insulating phase. However, the whole resistance goes to zero, and then it does not diverge at that point, but rather it is finite and gets to a point at which it becomes the H over NEC, which is the canonical value for a whole insulating phase, above which it diverges, as it is expected for any, say, Fermi insulating system. So let me conclude. We looked at superconductor insulator transition in the presence of magnetic field as a function of disorder. In the weak disorder regime, we see weak magnetoresistance, appearance of a metallic phase, and true superconductivity is achieved only at very low magnetic fields. In the regime of strong disorder, there is a critical behavior as observed from a finite temperature. It is consistent with quantum percolation. And in these films, there is a strong insulating behavior. The magnetoresistance goes diverges. And in this phase, we find a whole insulating phase near the SIT and self-duality at the superconductor to insulator transition. All these are showing that this transition is in the same universality class as the quantum hole to insulator transition. Thank you. So others did it. We did not do it yet.
But you would expect that in India.
There is a. Yeah. So people who did do this kind of behavior as a function of angle found that as they go. I mean, there is a critical point, namely there is a crossing point. And it changes as a function of the angle as you go towards. But there is a crossing point even at parallel at parallel
just field. But what's the critical field now in the fair line again? So it's a critical field
there. No. So in the strong disorder regime, the critical field. Goes to zero, in fact, goes to become, in this, so the critical field becomes smaller and smaller and smaller, so the scale of that field becomes smaller and smaller and smaller.
Yeah, so this would expect this, this could also
exactly.
Exactly.
Yes. Yes. Yep. So, I think that you're still fine because it's still even below HC2. And HC2 is not a power limiting. Yeah.
Yep.
No. So for the vortices, I mean, it's. I think that, in simple language, I would say that there is an effective number of Cooper pairs, if you want, that participate. And I gave the analogy. This is now interpretation. I mean, the experimental result is an experimental result. Now, the way I see it is, and I try to give an analogy of a Johnson junction. If I have I mean, I can still have self-duality in a single Johnson junction, despite the fact that I have two sides of the junction that have many, many, many Cooper pairs. I can still talk about one Cooper pair going across the junction and one vortex traversing the junction. So I'm looking at it from, I think that in an inhomogeneous system, it is not difficult to achieve this kind of situation. Yes. Except that, as you know I think that we capture with the measurements confining ourselves to lower fields, we capture. What happens here, we captured, I think, quite well. Now, what happened here is that you see the whole resistance increases. It gets, at this point, according to our high field measurements, we get exactly the slope, and therefore we know exactly H over N and C, which is exactly this point. Seriously, the error bar is the size of this point. There is a kink here, and I think that this is an insulating behavior, but as you know from a normal Fermi insulating behavior, the whole resistance of weakly localized systems, because we started from a Fermi system not near H over E squared. We started from a Fermi system only of a couple of a few kilohms, and therefore it's very weak insulating behavior. And as you know, in weak insulating behavior, just starting the variable range hopping, the whole behavior is even weaker. So I consider this as, if I go with this to lower temperature, this is going to divert just like the longitudinal wave. Yes. Yes. Signals. What's the problem? What's the problem in getting sigma out of the?
It looks like Boltzmann is zero.
Yes, it's zero here, and then it's finite. Yeah. Zero here, at down in the superconducting phase it's zero, and then it's finite. It starts from zero at the SIT and gets to H over NEC at the crossing of the Hall effect. Sigma XY is finite below the SIT, zero all the way, and where the Hall effect, where the Hall gets to H over NEC, it starts to be finite. Yes? So if you are not hampered by other effects and you are still able to measure the Hall effect, I don't think that anything from here down, I don't think anything is going to happen. From here up, this is going to infinity and this is going to...
Right, but if I look at the curves on top, it's a crossing, so it means that the slope should go up and up and up until it's
Yeah, so that's the point that I was trying, well, I didn't have much time. Even if you look at Hebbard and Talman data, you see that there is much more of a splaying. So yes, it looks like there is a crossing, but we don't believe that the crossing is going all the way. We think that the crossing is being tighter towards this finite value. Let me show you in the Hebbard and Talman. You can see it as well. You see, we see exactly the same thing. We see that it's very tight here. So we don't think that the crossing here, and then it splays out. So we think that it's, yes, it looks like there is a crossing, but it's not really a crossing. We believe that it's going to tighten up onto that.
Asymmetric behavior on both sides of the field. One side it
This is not the superconductor to insulator transition.
No, but
the other one. I mean, you know, this is what we find. Now I'm telling you what I believe is going to happen. I believe that this is going, that this behavior is going to stay, and this one will go. This is my yes.
Have you looked at the
not in the we did some a lot in the metallic phases, not much here. All the measurements that I showed were done in linear response.
Because this case is the one
Yeah, but this was a different way to look at duality. We looked at duality by looking at the full two-dimensional resistivity matrix. And this is all in the... Okay, but we did not do... We did not look at nonlinear. In fact, we tried very hard to stay in our responses.
Last question in the back.
Can you say about me, where is the transition between the metallic phase and the self-dual phase? The function of
so the strong dissolver, we never see metallic behavior. Yeah. In
but
the strong,
you say strong and weak. Where is the transition? Is it sharp or crossover?
We don't, I mean, I can tell you roughly in what, for indium oxide, for example, where it happened. But let me also say something about disorder. I mean, you asked me where here there is this transition from
weak. Where is the crossover or sharp?
Right. So first of all, I don't know. Second, because I don't have a single film that I can tune that, at least not for now. But there is also, when I say strong and weak, I characterize it by some features I see in the material. For example, the strong magnetoresistance, etc. Now, remember that from the point of view of superconductivity, characterizing the disorder is very tricky. I can take an amorphous metal for which K Fermiel is of order 1, and from the point of view of Anderson localization, you will tell me, you know, this is very close to be an insulator, an Anderson insulator. But from the point of view of a superconducting insulating phase, it's going to be very difficult to pin vortices in a perfect amorphous material. So it's kind of tricky to define the disorder. So just to answer your question, I don't know where it is in this system.
So I